thrilled that you guys came today. And I do want to, before we start the message, it's been a difficult week in our country. And I wanted to take a few minutes, just dedicated moments, to pray with all of you. I've been praying, I'm sure you have been praying for our country as everything's been going on. And I want to say a few things before we pray, and they are words of encouragement. The first thing I would say to you, if you've felt some anxiety because of some stuff that have been going on, because of the stuff that has been going on this week, the mistake you have been making, the mistake that I have been making, is that I have focused my attention on the stuff rather than on Jesus. Because you know what it says in Scripture, right? Isaiah 26:3 says, "Fix your mind upon the Lord, not upon your circumstance. Fix your mind upon the Lord, and you shall experience peace. For in so doing, you prove that you place your trust in Him." Now, if you're fixing your mind on the things that have been going on for months now, I mean, this isn't anything new, is it? If you're choosing to fix your mind on the stuff, you're bound to feel anxiety. Now, choosing to fix your mind upon God is not going to change the stuff necessarily, but you will be reminded that your destiny, our destiny, is not determined by anyone or anything else but Jesus. Somebody needs to say amen to that, okay? When you fix your mind upon the Lord, you shall experience peace, because you are proving to yourself and to God where you are placing your trust. So we're going to do that. We're going to pray for our country for the next few moments, but we're also going to be very intentional about choosing to place to fix our mind upon God. All right, let's pray. Lord, as we come before you this morning as Americans, first of all, but as Christians most specifically, there is concern. We have concerns. But we have chosen, Lord, to lift those concerns to you, to trust and believe, Jesus, that you can take all things and work them to the good for your purpose and for your plan. And with that in mind, with confidence, we come before you today, and we lift our country to you. We lift our leaders to you. We ask, Jesus, that you would move in the midst of all of us, Lord. I'm praying, Jesus, that you would pour out a spirit of revival upon our country, because I truly believe that that is our only hope. And when we choose to fix our mind upon you, when we choose to pray for a spirit of repentance and conviction and revival, we can believe, Lord, that there is hope. And that you have a plan. That's part of what we're going to be talking about today. That's part of what the journey is going to be that we're going to be on as a church during this year. Focusing on and desiring to understand the mission that you have called us to as the church. The difference that you have called us to make in the corridor, in our country, and in the world. Because the mission that you have called us to is one that will and should impact the entirety of the world. That's an overwhelming thought, but we know, Lord, that your Scripture gives us guidance, and you've broken it down in simple, not easy, but simple ways that will help us, Jesus, to keep our focus on you and not to be overcome by the enormity of the task that lies in front of us. So we lift our country to you, Lord. We claim the calling that we have to be in prayer, to stand in the gap, praying for our country and for our world, asking, Lord, that you would pour out your Spirit upon us, knowing that our only hope is you. So with those things in mind, we give ourselves to the Scripture that you have led us to, not just today, but we will be learning and discerning in the coming weeks and months, knowing, Lord, that you have equipped us for this task, and trusting that when your Holy Spirit empowers us, even this task is as daunting as it is, can and shall be accomplished, because it's not us doing it, it's you. We pray these things in Jesus' name. And everybody said, amen. Amen. You know, I've shared with you all before that a part of my calling to ministry, but I don't know if I've shared this part with you, and I wanted to do that today. When I first, I didn't grow up going to church. I've shared that part with you for sure. So when I first began to sense that the Holy Spirit was calling me into ministry, it scared me to death for a whole variety of reasons. There were just the idea, the lifestyle, what was expected of a pastor was beyond my comprehension. A lot of things, and just the globally thinking about it scared me, but the specifics of it scared me even more. I'll give you an example I'm talking about. I remember early on when I started to sense the moving of the Spirit in my life saying, I want you to be a pastor. I remember thinking, what am I going to say? I couldn't envision preaching in general. I couldn't envision what I would say for 4 weeks in a row, let alone for four decades in a row, right? Scared me to death. I think, Lord, I can't do this. Now, obviously, because I'm old and I've been doing this for a long time, I've figured some of that out, right? And you want to know what I've really figured out over the years? Probably the most important thing that I have figured out over the course of my trying to live into my calling as a pastor. The most important thing that I've figured out is that back then in particular, but I tend to do it even today, I have a tendency to make things more complicated than they really are. Am I alone in that? Anybody else ever do that? And the more important the thing is, the more complicated I try to make it. Because I think if it's that important, it's got to be difficult and it's got to be complicated, which is true sometimes, but not always. Let me give you an example of what I'm talking about. Something really important. The mission of the church. What is the mission of the church? The mission of the church is to bring hope and salvation to the world. Now, that, if you think about that, if you really allow yourself to, instead of it just being a theological concept, but you start actually thinking, oh my gosh, you're thinking, that, what, I have no idea. What do I do? Where do I start? And here's the deal. If you've accepted Jesus as your Lord and Savior, you are the church. A lot of people think, well, no, Pastor, you are the church. You're supposed to. No. You are the church. And you have been called to bring hope and salvation to the world. And I know that sounds scary, but listen to me. God has laid out the plan and the strategy for you to be the church. And we find it in this New Testament book of Acts. Now, this is what we're going to be doing this year. I share that with you. Because this year, 2021, we're going to spend most of the year journeying through the book of Acts so that we can discern together God's plan, God's strategy for fulfilling the mission, for bringing hope and salvation to the world. And what you'll discover is that it's not nearly as complicated as you think. It's not easy either, but it's not nearly as complicated as you think, especially as we begin. You know, you ever heard the old saying, how do you eat an elephant? One bite at a time, right? That's the way God lays it out for us in Scripture, and that's what we're going to be talking. We're still going to be doing, celebrating Christmas and Easter and all the things that we do this year. We're still going to be doing two all-church book studies that we normally do, but most of the year, we're going to be spending journeying through the book of Acts. So if y'all are wondering what's going to be happening this year, at least as part of Prairie Bible, that's what we're going to be doing. So if you got your Bibles, I want you to go ahead and open them up to Acts chapter 1. And if you don't have your Bibles, why not? Bring your Bibles. Just humor me. Even if you don't open them up, just humor me, okay? Bring them. But it's a really good thing because this is what we're going to be doing. We're going to be looking as we journey through the book of Acts. It's going to be one chapter at a time. So this is chapter one. Next week will be chapter two. You get where I'm going with that? So bring your Bibles. I'm not going to be reading every verse of chapter one to you today. I'm going to be walking with you through chapter one. So you having your Bibles will be a good thing. So you can kind of gather context that maybe I may not speak to specifically, and you may have questions about that. So having your Bibles with you will be a good thing. So this is how it starts. The resurrected Jesus. You may not have been aware of this, but did you know that after Jesus resurrected from the dead, a lot of times we think, well, as soon as Jesus resurrected, he ascended into heaven. No. Actually, Jesus was resurrected from the dead, right, on Easter morning, and for 40 days, the Bible tells us, he walked with the church. Well, they weren't the church yet. They were his apostles. And I'll explain that to you in just a moment. He walked with the disciples for 40 days, teaching them and preparing them. And where we're picking up today in Acts chapter 1 is Jesus is preparing to ascend into heaven, and he's giving his disciples, his apostles, one final kind of word of wisdom and a piece or their direction for what is to come ahead. He says in Acts chapter 1 verse 4, he says, I want you to go to Jerusalem. Right now, they're just kind of outside of Jerusalem, not far. I want you to go to Jerusalem and wait. That was it. He said, go to Jerusalem and wait. But wait for what? Well, he follows up with them. He says, this is what you're going to do. You're going to go to Jerusalem, and you're going to be there a few days. If you read the scripture, if you're reading your Bibles right now, you'll see that. It says you're going to go to Jerusalem, you're going to be there a few days, and then you will be baptized with the power of the Holy Spirit. Now, that's pretty exciting, and the disciples, upon hearing this, they become curious, right? And they go, well, is this when you're going to bring glory to the kingdom of Israel? And Jesus just kind of looks at them and goes, oh, you God. You got to listen to me, guys. What I am about to send you out into is far bigger than the nation of Israel. He says, for when I baptize you in the power of the Holy Spirit, you will be called, sent out to bring the hope and salvation of the gospel to who? To Israel? Yeah, but to the whole world, not just Israel. You're being sent out to give the hope of the gospel to the whole world. And then I imagine they're going, oh, jeez. I mean, it was a big enough deal that they were going to be bringing it to Israel. But now the Jesus says, no, this is the whole world. You're responsible for bringing the gospel to the whole world. And they're going, oh, what am I supposed to do? Where do I start? And Jesus said, what did I just tell you? Because he just told them, didn't he? What did he say? Go to Jerusalem and wait. Can it be that simple? People that know me would say that I have a type A personality. Which means I don't wait very well. I want to be doing things on my day off. I work my tail off just because it makes me feel good to work my tail off. I just like doing stuff. I want to be doing stuff. So waiting is the last thing that I want to do. And I have a suspicion that some of the apostles, especially Peter, was just like me. Because they knew that Jesus had said what? Go to Jerusalem and wait. But they're thinking, there's got to be something we can be doing while we're waiting, right? You got to be efficient. You got to use your time well. So what can we, and they look around, they say, you know what we need to do? We got a problem. We had a problem. We got a problem. Judas, one of their disciples, one of the apostles had betrayed Jesus and then hung himself from a tree. So we need to replace this guy, right? So they said, maybe we should be doing that while we're waiting. So they gather together and they say, well, you know, guys, we should be doing this. And they think, yeah, let's create a personality profile. Let's create a job description. What do we need? What are we looking for to fulfill this? What kind of person do we want to fulfill this position of the 12th apostle? And they said, well, let's keep it simple. We want somebody that has been around for a while and that we know well. Good. That's a good choice. I think it went without saying that the person should be a Christian, right? They should have accepted, should know Jesus and love Jesus. But that what they're really looking for was someone, and this makes a lot of sense to me, doesn't it to you? Let's choose somebody that's been around for a long time and that we can trust, we know we can get along with. If I was building a staff, that's what I would do. That's the kind of stuff. That's where I would start. So, if you read the scripture, what happens? They identify two people who kind of fit the personality profile. One's got, they call him Joseph, but he's got other names. Barsabbas and Justice, but they called him Joseph, apparently. I bet they called him Joe. And the second guy was named Matthias. And then this next part, I love this next part, right? The next part is, it says that they chose the two, and they said, we don't want to be too presumptuous. So they prayed. They said, Lord, these are the two people we've chosen to replace Judas, and we need your help. We want it to be your choice, Lord. So help us. And it says in verse 26, look through your Bible, see what it says in verse 26. You know what it says in verse 26? It says that they cast lots, which I think is funny. It rolls, basically, or they're throwing some dice up against the wall. Now, that's what it is. I did some study to figure out what it was. I was just rolling it up against the wall. And through this very holy way of seeking God's wisdom, gambling, the die, I bet they thought, well, you know, God is God, so God can control which way the dice are going to roll, right? That's probably what they were thinking. And the dice fell Matthias's way. And so they named Matthias the 12th disciple. The famous Matthias became the 12th disciple. Y'all know of Matthias and all his wonderful and supernatural exploits that are described from them then on in the Bible, right? Y'all know that? Some of you know, but some of you are going like this. Did anybody go, yeah, I've heard of him. Anybody? Because if you've heard of him, I don't know what Bible you're reading. Because as far as I know, Matthias is never again referred to ever after that moment. And you might ask, why? Why do you think? Well, maybe he wasn't as godly as they thought, right? But I don't think that's it. I don't know, honestly. But I don't think that's it because I guess he probably loved the Lord. I can tell you beyond a shadow of a doubt why, though. Because I've read the rest of the book. It's because Matthias was not the person that God wanted to be the 12th disciple. God already had that figured out, didn't he? As we continue on our journey through the book of Acts, we'll discover who God wanted to be the 12th disciple. And by the way, it was a person that none of them would have chosen. They would never have created a personality profile that looked like that guy. But that's another sermon, okay? What was the mistake they made? What had God asked them to do? Go to Jerusalem and wait. Remember earlier when I was telling you I was scared to death the thought of what am I going to preach on for the next 40 years? What was the mistake I made? I made it more complicated than it was because God didn't ask me to figure out what I was going to preach for the next 40 years. God asked Craig, Are you available? Are you willing? All right. I don't know if you've been listening to me up to this point or not, but please, for the next minute or two, listen. Because what I'm about to say is important. If you have accepted Jesus Christ into your heart as Lord and Savior, you have been called by God to bring the hope and salvation of the gospel to the world. You have been. Now, some of you, you hear that and you go, I don't know what that means. And I get that. You think, I can't do what Craig can do. Well, guess what? You weren't called to do what Craig can do. You were called to be who God created you to be. Don't make it more complicated than it is. You have been called. And God wants to equip you. And the place to start to figure that all out, if you haven't figured it out yet, is to wait upon the Lord. Now, you hear waiting upon, what does it mean to wait? To wait doesn't mean just sit on your rear ends in church on Sunday morning. That is not what it means to wait upon the Lord. Waiting upon the Lord is active. It's a verb. Waiting upon the Lord means keep going to Him. Keep reaching out. Yeah, maybe part of that is coming to church on Sunday morning, but it's also praying every chance you get. Lord, I need you. I can't do this. And He goes, I know you can't do it. Wait upon the Lord. Read your Bibles. Gather around people, godly influences that will help and encourage you. And guess what? The Bible says that you will be baptized in the Holy Spirit and you will receive guidance and direction and power to be the Jesus that you were created to be. And that's scary, I get it, but I'm telling you right now, it will fill your life with purpose and meaning. It will not take away the pain that your life has, but it will give you purpose in the midst of the pain. It will not be easy, but it will be simple. In fact, I would go so far as to say to you, once you give yourself to that and you wait upon the Lord and He begins to answer you and guide you and equip you for what you were created to be, your biggest problem isn't going to be, what am I supposed to do? Your biggest problem is, will I have the courage to actually do it? Listen to me. The world we live in today, I'm telling you right now, I don't think we have time to play church. We need to be the church. Folks, we need to be the church. And I can't tell you what that is for you. That's between you and Jesus. You need to be figuring that out. And I'm saying you need to be figuring it out soon. Because I don't think we've got a lot of time to waste. Whatever that means to you, I don't believe that we got a lot of time to waste. You need to start being the Jesus that God created you to be. And if you don't know what that looks like, then get down on your knees and start waiting upon the Lord. And don't stop until He shows you. If you have never accepted Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, maybe today is the day. It's time to stop waiting. If you don't know if you've accepted Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior, that's one of those things that you need to have figured out. You don't want to leave that one up to chance. If you haven't accepted Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, I would be privileged to pray that prayer of salvation with you today. Jesse and the band are up here, and well, during our final song, I'll be right over there in the prayer room. And if there's any of you that would like to accept Christ as your Lord and Savior, I'd pray that prayer with you today. Now, there may be other things that you need to pray about, and you'd like me to pray. I would be privileged to pray with you about whatever is on your heart. because God is listening. And God is calling us to understand, to stop wasting time. Don't just wait, but wait upon the Lord.
Who else needs the Lord this morning? I know that I do. So would you please stand if you're able? Let's cry out to God and acknowledge that we need Him. Spirit and the way that He speaks, but I feel very strongly there's someone in this room that needs to know how badly they need Jesus, that needs to cry out before God and get down on their knees in the posture of their heart to repent and to really accept that the Lord is Jesus. And so I'm going to sing this chorus again that we sang earlier. The words will not be up on the screen, but we all know it, so we're going to sing it again. And I'm desperate for You. Sing this again. And I'm alone. lost without you. Would you please pray with me? Lord Jesus, we are desperate for you in this hour. With everything that's happening in this country, with everything that's happened over the past year, with all of our normal hurts and hang-ups and trials of life, we acknowledge our need. But we acknowledge that our greatest need is to come to know you and to receive the Holy Spirit, to be sealed, Lord. And so if that's any of us this morning, I just pray that you would cause us to repent, that you would bring us into a knowledge of Jesus Christ like we have never known before. And that if we are in Christ, you would equip us this morning to go out into the world and to preach the gospel to all the nations as you have intended. We pray and we ask these things in the mighty name of Jesus. Amen. Thank you. Have a blessed week. Yeah.